Good afternoon. This is when you perhaps move back into afternoon sessions in their normal mode, which may be you struggling with your blood sugar level or something. But we're going to take as our sort of opening text, our biblical text for this session, the words of the evangelist Myrid McGuinness. She said, nobody talks about weakening retailers. Well, we might have that text in mind as we move into this next session. The format is pretty well the same as it was last time I was on this stage, which is to say there'll be a keynote speech and then some responses from people on these chairs next to me. Can I ask the panelists then to come up and join me here? Otherwise, I might be a bit lonely. A man who doesn't need steps. Excellent. I'm impressed. I've lost the other members of the panel. There's good. Werner Vucher, who is sitting on my left, your right, is from the Rewe Group. He is an Austrian from Carinthia. So not so many millions of miles from Janusz Potocznik's territory, really. Neighbours. And John Atkin is Chief Operating Officer of Syngenta and Syngenta's crop protection area, and will have taken to heart that contribution from the anonymous contributor earlier. And Mela Fruin, who, have you ever voted for Myrid McGuinness?
Certainly, yes.
Oh, there we go. That was an honest answer. An Irish citizen who is Director General of the CIAA. When are you going to change your name to FBI?
We have given it a lot of thought, and we will be changing our name on the 23rd of June.
23rd of June.
Yes.
What will you be changing it to?
Well, I'm afraid this,
you're going to
this
change
is
it.
A big surprise.
You're going to change it to FBI,
it will not
aren't
be
you?
The food. It will not be the food and beverage industry, FBI.
The food and beverage industry would have such a neatness about it, you know. Anyway, okay, from the Confederation of the Food and Drink Industries of the EU. For the moment, this informed panel who really take our discussions further up the food chain, they sit back, as I do, and we welcome Lester Brown, who was speaking on a panel earlier. We welcome him to the podium now to give a fuller presentation of some of his thoughts. Thank you very much, Lester.
Thank you, Tim. In looking at the world food situation today, there are roughly, or essentially, two schools of thought. One school says this is a temporary situation. The other says it's a chronic situation. If you saw The Economist a few weeks ago and read the cover story, you would have noted in that one-page summary up front of the longer feature, the third paragraph began by saying, this is a temporary situation. I'm not so sure. Their argument was that this is event-driven. I think we're facing a more fundamental, trend-driven rise in food prices. And that is basically what I would like to talk about this year. I think this food crisis began in 07, 08. And had it not been for the Great Recession and the largest grain crop on record in 2008, that rise would have continued. As it was, it went up, it dipped for a year or so, and now is going back up again, in some cases setting record highs. This year's grain harvest, this upcoming grain harvest, is probably going to get more attention than any grain harvest in history. The big question is, can we produce enough this year to return to a state of normalcy, if you will, in the world grain market? I doubt it. The other question is, can we maintain the status quo? Maybe. But even that is not guaranteed. Last year, world grain consumption exceeded production by 60 million tons. So in order not to draw down stocks further, we would need a 60 million ton increase this year. We also need a 40 million ton increase to cover the growth in demand this year over last year. The question is, can we get a 100 million ton increase in order to maintain the rather unstable status quo? The second question is, can we raise production enough to return things to at least somewhere near normal? That would take an increase of 150 million tons. Let's look quickly at the big three grains that account for 90% of the grain harvest. Rice is the most predictable because it's almost all grown with irrigation. It doesn't fluctuate very much. The average increase is, say, 7 million tons a year for the last several years. Let's assume that we get 10 million tons from rice this year. Then we look at wheat. And we know quite a bit about this year's wheat harvest because most of it was planted last fall. Most of it's grown in the west, in the northern hemisphere. And we have some sense of the condition of the wheat crop. We know that in two of the big three of the big four grain producers, namely China and the United States, we're looking at subpar wheat harvest because of drought. The question is exactly how much. India, which is also one of the big four producers, is going to have a good crop this year, probably 83 million tons versus 81 million last year. Russia almost certainly will be up this year, unless they get another heat wave like last year, almost certainly be up, but it won't be a bumper crop either because the Russians didn't get about a fifth of their winter wheat planted, and instead they'll be planting that land in spring wheat, which yields only about two-thirds as much. So Russia's not off to a great start. So as we look at this year's wheat harvest, the International Grains Council said they think maybe we'll get a 24 million ton increase. The Canadian Wheat Board more recently said we think maybe a 5 million ton increase. Let's assume a 20 million ton increase from the world wheat harvest this year. We now have 30 million tons, 10 million from rice, 20 million from wheat. Then the other big one is corn, of course. In the U.S., the planted area is going to be expanding, according to the preliminary intentions reports, by 4%. And last year, our corn yields were down, and so if we can get them up this year, we might be able to get another maybe 30 or possibly 40 million tons of grain from an increased corn harvest. But altogether, it's a little difficult to see how we're going to get beyond an 80 million ton increase this year, which means we're going to be drawing down stocks a bit to cover that 100 million tons I mentioned earlier. And we're almost certainly not going to get 150 million tons. It would let us relax a bit. As most of you know, FAO's World Food Index has now shown eight consecutive monthly rises. My guess is we're going to see a few more rises, that food prices are going to go a bit higher in the months ahead than they are now. Historically, when we've had price surges, monsoon failure in India in 1965, drought in the Soviet Union 1972, for example, these were event-driven increases in grain prices. And they didn't last very long because in the U.S. we had a lot of idled cropland. We also had enormous stocks of grain. After the Indian monsoon failure in 1965, we shipped a fifth of the U.S. wheat harvest to India alone to avoid famine. But it wasn't a big deal. We had huge stocks. We couldn't do that today. But beyond that, we also had cropland idled under farm programs. And each year at USDA, we would calculate how much we wanted to set aside that year. And if prices had surged, we would increase the area planted. And in a year or so, things would be back to normal. We don't have either those large reserves today or that idled cropland. The world is more or less flat out in terms of production. That doesn't mean there won't be increases in the future, but we don't have idled cropland that we can quickly bring back into play. I think we're looking now at a trend-driven increase in world grain prices. On the demand side, we have population growth, 80 million people a year. That means that at the dinner table tonight, there will be 219,000 people who were not there last night. And tomorrow night, there will be another 219,000. At some point, that increase begins to both press on the Earth's land and water resources and to tax the skills of the world's farmers. The second source of growing demand for food is that there are roughly 3 billion people in the world now who are trying to move up the food chain, consuming more grain-intensive livestock products. The third source of grain is the growing demand for grain to produce fuel for cars. In the year 2000 in the United States, we were converting something like 20 million tons of grain into fuel for cars. Last year, it was 124 million tons. That's 124 million tons out of a 400 million ton grain harvest. That's a huge amount of grain going to fuel cars that's no longer available for feed or for food. If you look at the growth in the world grain harvest, I'm sorry, in world grain consumption, from 1990 to 2005, over that 15-year period, the average annual growth in world grain consumption was 21 million tons a year. If you look at the most recent five-year period from 2005 to 2010, it was 41 million tons per year. The growth in the world demand for grain doubled during that period. And the big factor was the massive diversion of grain to fuel for cars in the United States. On the supply side, so on the demand side, we now have three trends driving demand: population growth, rising affluence, and the demand for grain to produce fuel for cars. What the latter does, by the way, is tie the price of grain to the price of oil. Because if the price of oil, as the price of oil goes up from, say, 100 to 150 or 200, the profitability of converting grain into ethanol goes up, and the price of ethanol will follow the price of oil, and the price of grain will follow the price of oil. And I don't think most economists have yet quite recognized the significance of that link. But it's a new reality that we're facing in the world in terms of the factors influencing grain prices. We've always known the rising oil prices would increase production costs. That's a given. But now, the rising price of oil will draw more grain into the production of fuel. The supply side. There are four trends that I'd like to mention. One is climate change. The rule of thumb that crop ecologists use for assessing the effect of rising temperature on grain yields is that for each 1 degree Celsius rise in temperature during the growing season, we can expect a 10% decline in grain yields. So rising temperatures, falling yields. Agriculture as it exists today evolved over an 11,000 year period of rather remarkable climate stability. There were a few blips here and there, the little ice age in the 13th or 14th century, but basically we had a rather stable climate over this long period. So agriculture as it exists today is designed to maximize production with that climate system. Now suddenly that system is changing. And so increasingly agriculture will be out of sync with the climate system. And we don't know exactly how much and how fast it will become out of sync, because we don't know exactly what changes in climate will be occurring. And there used to be a climate norm to return to. We knew that after there was a price hike someplace, we could get back to normal and climate would go back to normal. But now we're in a state of constant flux with the Earth's climate. The second factor is falling water tables. There are 18 countries in the world that we know of where water tables are falling. These 18 countries include over half the world's people. They include the big three grain producers, China, India, and the United States. Overpumping is by definition a short-term phenomenon. You can overpump in the short run, but not in the long run. So what's happening now is that we are creating water-based food bubbles. We are artificially inflating grain production in a number of countries by overpumping aquifers. But if you overpump aquifers, eventually you deplete the aquifers. And when you deplete the aquifers, the grain production drops. The pumping drops to the rate of recharge, necessarily. So we have these food bubbles of various sizes in some 18 countries. They're beginning to burst. And the first one has been a rather dramatic one in Saudi Arabia. After the oil export embargo of the 1970s, the Saudis realized they would be vulnerable to a grain counter-export embargo. So they began trying to figure out what to do. Using their oil drilling technology, they discovered an aquifer about a half mile down. This aquifer, unlike most aquifers, is a fossil aquifer. That is, there is no recharge. This was water that was put down eons ago. And they've been pumping that to be self-sufficient in wheat production for more than 20 years. In early 2008, they announced that that aquifer was largely depleted and that they would be phasing out their wheat production. And during the 3 years since then, their wheat production has dropped by two-thirds. And within another year or two, it will disappear entirely, and the Saudis will be totally dependent on imported grain. Now, 3 million tons is not a huge amount of wheat. We produce over 600 million tons, so 3 million tons is half of 1%. But it is a loss. And the Saudis can afford to compete for grain in the world market, so that's not a major issue either. But what is interesting here is that it is the first and the most dramatic country in which a water bubble has burst. The others will not be so dramatic because most are sustainable aquifers rather than fossil aquifers. But grain production has peaked in Syria. It has peaked in Iraq, in addition to Saudi Arabia. And if you look at the Arab Middle East now, grain production for the region has peaked and is declining because of water shortages. This is the first region where we've actually had an absolute decline in grain production because of a loss of irrigation water. I estimate the Saudi grain bubble at about the grain supply for about 10 million people. We've just lost that capacity to feed 10 million people from that aquifer because it's disappearing. But the big food bubbles are in India and China. The World Bank estimates that 175 million people in India are being fed with grain produced by overpumping. This is a huge bubble. If you want it in terms of consumption, it's the food supply of 175 million people living in India. We estimate that the food bubble in China, which is mostly overpumping under the North China Plain, is about 130, equals the food supply of about 130 million Chinese. And there are other countries with varying size food bubbles. In the United States, we have seen the irrigated area in a number of states decline, including important agricultural states like California and Texas. California has lost at least a million acres of irrigated cropland, partly because of depletion of the aquifer under the Central Valley, but partly also because of diversion to cities. Farmers selling their irrigation water rights to cities, simply because it's much more profitable than using the water for irrigation. The water issue is a sleeper issue. It is not visible. You can't photograph falling water tables. You know when the wells go dry that you're in trouble. Exactly when these bubbles will burst and how dramatic it will be, whether it will be very abrupt or gradual, we don't know. We haven't been here before, and we really don't have the information needed to make that judgment. But this is going to be a real challenge in terms of for the world's farmers to maintain production in a lot of the countries where these water-based food bubbles exist. We have probably reached peak water at about the same time we're reaching peak oil. I doubt that the world irrigated area is going to increase very much in the future, if at all. A third trend is soil erosion. Someone said soil erosion is like the tires on your car. If you keep driving with the same tires, eventually they wear thin enough that you'll have a blowout. Soil erosion is like that. It doesn't happen all at once. It happens just a little bit at a time until eventually you realize you're losing a lot of topsoil. You're starting to abandon cropland because it's no longer productive enough to plant. So we're seeing countries like Mongolia, Lesotho, where grain production has peaked and is declining because of soil erosion. We see other countries like North Korea and Haiti where production is not declining, but it's not increasing either because efforts to increase it are being offset by the losses from soil erosion. So now we have three trends. We have climate change, we have bursting water bubbles, and we have soil erosion, making it more difficult for farmers to expand production fast enough. And the fourth trend is one I mentioned this morning, which is in the more agriculturally advanced countries, we seem to be running out of technology to continue raising yields. I mentioned that here in Europe, wheat yields had not increased for the past decade in France, and close to that now in the UK and in Germany, the big three wheat producers in Europe. Now, maybe we can somehow break out of that plateau, but right now, farmers would like to produce more wheat per hectare, but they don't have any readily available technologies to do that. A similar situation exists in Asia, where rice yields plateaued in Japan 16 years ago. Japan was the first country in the world to launch a sustained rise in grain yield per acre. They began in the 1880s. The rest of the world didn't begin until after World War II. But in Japan, there are no technologies available now to enable farmers to raise yields further. Not that they wouldn't like to, because support prices in Japan for rice, I think, are something like three times the world market price. They're really very high. But farmers can't do anything to go further. Even more disturbing, rice yields in Japan that 40 years ago were well below, in China, which 40 years ago were well below those in Japan, have now largely closed the gap. And unless China can take its rice yields above those in Japan, which I sort of doubt, then rice yields in China are about to plateau also. If they do, then the rice harvest in China and Japan, which represents at least a third of the world rice harvest, will no longer be increasing. So these countries where yields are plateauing are making it more difficult for the world to maintain rapid growth in the grain harvest that will keep up with the rapid growth in demand. Another half hour. No, kidding. I'm just wrapping up with three final points. One is that we are, with world grain stocks being as low as they are now, and given the increasing climate volatility that farmers face, we're only one poor harvest away from chaos in world grain markets. I use the example in the book, World on the Edge, of which copies were available earlier, but I think they're all gone now. We know that the heat wave in Russia reduced the wheat harvest by roughly 40%. They had been hoping for close to 100 million tons, and it dropped to 60 million tons. If that heat wave had been centered not in Moscow, but in Chicago, and the U.S. had lost 40% of its grain harvest, 40% of 400 million tons, then the world would have lost not 40 million tons, but 160 million tons of grain. That would have dropped world grain stocks the lowest level on record by a wide margin. Prices would have gone who knows how high. And exporting countries would have begun to restrict exports in order to keep their domestic food prices under control. Most likely, the oil exporting countries would have begun to barter oil for grain to make sure they could get the grain they needed. And then the rest of the world, including a lot of lower income countries, would have been competing for whatever was left. The political instability, the number of failing states could have increased, would increase dramatically. Second point in wrapping up, we have been focusing in this country, I'm sorry, in this conference on agriculture and agricultural policy, and particularly the agriculture and environmental interface in the common agricultural policy. But the new reality is that food security now goes far beyond ministries of agriculture. I was in China a year or two ago launching a book in Chinese and talking to a group of political leaders. And I suggested to them that they needed to build a phone line from the Ministry of Agriculture to the Ministry of Energy, because they need to talk with each other, because the decisions being made in the Ministry of Energy were probably going to have a far greater effect on China's long-term food security and the world's than decisions being made in their Ministry of Agriculture. Whether it's transportation policy, energy policy, land use policy, water, the Ministry of Water Resources may have as much influence now on future grain production as the Ministry of Agriculture. So it's become a societal challenge now. Food security is no longer just the province of farmers and the Ministry of Agriculture. It goes far beyond that. And my concluding point is this. We have inherited from the last century a definition of food security, I'm sorry, a definition of security that is defined almost exclusively in military terms. During the last century, we had two world wars, we had a Cold War, and so we've carried over in the 21st century that military definition of security. But if you were to sit down today with a clean pad and list the threats to our future, the threats to our future in the 21st century, on my list at least, climate change would be at the top of the list. Then falling water tables, population growth, soil erosion. armed aggression probably would not even make the top five in my list of threats to national security or to global security now. There really is no national security by itself unless we have global security. And I'm not talking about just reconceptualizing this in intellectual terms. I'm talking about restructuring the what we now call the defense budget to shift resources into things like population stabilization, climate stabilization, raising water efficiency, et cetera, et cetera. I think it's time to redefine security, not only in intellectual terms, but in fiscal terms. Thank you very much for your attention.
Lester, thank you for that. And now we have a challenge for our panel, both conceptually and time-wise. And let me, I'll say something and somebody will contradict me from down there. But I'm aiming at 15:25. At 15:25, I want you to be finding your voting tools. But what we've been hearing through the morning and in this first contribution to our afternoon is about how a world appears to have changed and how the farming world must adapt to that or possibly die, or we plunder the world's environmental resources and that's just delayed dying. But my question here is about how does the food industry change to adapt to those changing circumstances, and is it doing so? I think I'm actually going to start with you, Van. In what way these messages about food security and food prices and so on, how are they changing the way that you're doing business? And I should perhaps say, by way of background, you're largely dealing with Central Europe.
Yes. Yes, and I would like to make a very short reaction also to previous speaker. I think it must be very frustrating for the farmers here that they hear since years that the supply, the demand will go up, and nothing is happening on the markets. So I think what is very important is that we have to make a distinction between European markets, and I do believe, and this is also my experience as food retailer, that there is a big difference. We can also include American, but European markets are special. And I think we have to differentiate in our strategy and also in our discussion between European markets and international markets. And speaking about European markets, I feel, and I think these are the main trends now, that the consumer in Europe is still very much focusing on sustainability and issues, you could say also subsumize under sustainability. I have a recent poll about in Austria, 58% of the consumers, they take sustainability into account when they buy something. And I also would like to give you two examples. On the one hand, I think organic production will still play an important role in Europe. Also, if you look to the figures in the last 2 years, so I think this is a very important issue, but also in the normal, conventional or industrialized production, we started to come up with a new label, we call it Pro Planet, where we try to include social but also ecological criteria, and not only CO2. I think this is very important in the discussion. It's about land use, water use, and also social criteria. There is a growing demand. And I think also in the strategy you have to differentiate between this European consumer and you have accept the European consumer. And in the morning you discussed a lot about the consumer, but it's reality because he's buying. And when he's not buying, we all together, retailer, food industry and producers, we have a common problem. And therefore I think this is something very important. We have to accept this and we also have to meet these needs.
I was simply going to ask, you say that in a poll in the Austrian market, 58% say that they're concerned about sustainability in their buying decisions. Are you doing the same polling in the Czech Republic?
Yes, and I think you still have different results. But we also started, for example, now in Slovakia and Czechia with organic brands. And I'm sure that, for example, an issue like...
No, but go on, give us some figures for what those results are for the Czech Republic and Slovakia at the moment.
I don't have them now right at the table.
Are they significantly...
They are still on developed markets. It's still increasing. And also, for example, if you look to the question of the origin of products, it's also in the UK an issue now. So I think that we really have to accept this and also that consumer needs, and when we discuss the freedom of choice of consumers, we really have to take this serious. So this is something which is given. And when you say how do we now meet the other issues, I think that besides sustainability, price is also an issue. So the consumer in Europe is we call it hybrid, you know. On the one hand, he wants to have very high quality, but at the cheapest price. And this is a given equation.
Let me quickly test that against a more general view of the European food industry, i.e. going to CAA, CIAA. Why can't it be FBI? I would much prefer it to be FBI. Anyway, the message I'm getting from my left is actually the message from Leicester is not really hugely changing the behavior of the food industry. Is that how you would represent things?
No, I think the message from your left came from the retail sector, which is fine, but from the food industry point of view, there are many things we can do. I think we're very dependent on agriculture in Europe, but also agriculture elsewhere in the world. So we use more than 70% of what's grown in Europe. So of course, it's top of mind for us to do this in a sustainable way in Europe. And also in the rest of the world. We have recently launched, it was already more than a year ago now, our sustainable roundtable. So it's a roundtable for sustainable consumption and production, which is being partnered by the European Commission. I'm very pleased to say they co-chair DG Environment, DG Enterprise, also DG Sanko, and the Joint Research Centre. What we're trying to do here is bring all the partners around the table to discuss the entire life cycle of the products that we produce.
But that's
and look at every single link there. How do we work from the farm and even input to the farm right down to the consumer's plates to deliver something that's more sustainable?
Forgive me, you're now having a discussion about sustainability which belongs in the session before lunch. I'm trying to ask how the food industry responds to a world in which Leicester's saying the game has changed. He's saying that scarcity levels are up there. He's saying that water resources are not being replenished. He's saying you're in a world of dust bowls. And this is a message that is being, it seems to me, preached to the agriculture industry. But the food industry is what? Enthralled to supermarkets and consumers, or what?
You can't separate them. I mean, you can't talk about feeding more people if you don't look at it sustainably. In fact, sustainability has three things. We heard about in the session just before lunch, we heard about the agricultural piece, and of course this is very, very important. So there's the social piece. There's also the environmental piece, which is very important, but there's also the economic piece. To be an industry and to survive as an industry, you must look at what you're doing and look at it's doing it sustainably. When we're facing all of these challenges that we all know about, it's almost scary, but I read the article in The Economist and I was glad to see that there were some good news stories there as well. I think we have to work like we're doing in our sustainability roundtable together to see if there's some way that we can do what we're doing more in a more environmentally friendly way, but also in an economic way, because the industry, in order to remain an industry, has to look at the bottom line. This goes without saying. If all of these people in Austria who want to eat organic, it's great. I mean, I think there's room for organic, there's room for everyone. But I think they should be prepared to pay for it, in my view. This is coming back on something that happened that was said earlier on today. If we want something, very specific, very particular, that costs more, because it does, then we should be prepared to put our hands in the in our pockets and pay for it. We should give the citizens, and I think we're all citizens, we should give them the choice. Maybe they want organic, that's great. Maybe they don't, they want conventional. Okay, maybe they want something that's cheaper. Well, give it to them if that's what they want. But then they have to be prepared to pay for the difference. And if farming cannot survive, I'm not talking just Europe, I'm talking in the rest of the world as well. If farming cannot survive on the prices it's getting, then it will have to be publicly funded.
And we alluded briefly earlier today to the subject of wastage. How is the food industry changing its ways to try and just basically reduce that scary figure about the amount of food produced that just is wasted? And a fair bit of that will be in storage, in especially outside Europe.
Yeah, the waste question is a very serious question. I think it's something that can really be done in order to tidy up our act. But unfortunately, a lot of this waste problem is actually not in our hands. Most of it, a recent study from the Commission, I think they came up with a figure of 43%, is in the household itself. So I think here education is important, and that's not our role. But for the piece that agriculture plays, you know, we really do try and cut down waste every day. We actually have very little waste because it's bad business. You know, you don't want to buy raw materials and then waste them. So we use every single bit of the material that we buy. There's all sorts of ways to reuse. First of all, what's waste? You have to look at what is waste, what is non-waste. Let's not call non-waste waste because it's not waste. What about what are byproducts? A lot of what we don't use, it's not waste. It goes into the animal feed industry. It can be used as fertilizer, etc.
I'm getting a picture. I'm going to have to cut you short to ask John, whose foot was twitching impatiently at a certain point there. What do you make of the response of retailers and food industry to that picture?
What do I make of it? I mean, there's a huge amount to say here. I think I sympathize a lot with what you're saying, but the fact of the matter is the consumer hasn't heard Leicester's message. They just haven't. They haven't heard in the sense of understanding. So I can see exactly what you're responding to. But if ever there was a more powerful argument for maximizing productivity in Europe, I haven't heard it. I mean, Leicester's case was very powerful. And I think in this whole story, we risk to underestimate the potential of the farmer to respond to what we ask him to do. I mean, Mairead McGuinness made it very clear that farming is a reflection of what society asks it to perform. And currently in Europe, it's being asked not to maximize productivity. It's being asked to do some other things. It's being asked to be sustainable. That's fine. It's being asked to be cost-effective. That's also fine. But it's not being asked right now to produce more. And I think this is where we've had the issue of flattening wheat yields. That's not because we can't get wheat yields up. We can. That's not been what farmers have been asked to do. They've had all sorts of other messages coming their way. What's fascinating is, and I wrote down a list of countries, including Japan, because a similar thing's happened in Japan. The politicians there, which, by the way, is the least self-sufficient country in the world, just about with 38% self-sufficiency, up until 2 years ago, there was no interest in maximizing and increasing rice yields, whereas in Indonesia, there was. And as a consequence, 2 years ago, they became self-sufficient in corn and rice. And you can have similar stories for Vietnam, Brazil, of course, with their great export drive, and Russia up until the issues that they face in the summer, where farmers are being told, and they get told through the value chain, through the food chain, they get told by political policy, where they're being told or asked or incentivized to produce more and to do it sustainably, by the way, they have a huge capacity to respond. So we're talking about millions of farmers here. They have no power in, they can choose what crops they want to grow within a framework of climate and soil restrictions, but they need some help around, do we want them to maximize technology and production? Do we want them to be sustainable at the same time? Which, as we heard this morning, these two things work together. They need some help. They need some support. They need to be told.
So, Werner, your listening to the consumer, and the consumer isn't linking in with Leicester, so the consumer is asking for perhaps the wrong thing.
No, but I think the consumer is never wrong. You know, this is the point, because he's buying at the supermarket. But my second point is that I was really clearly differentiating between the domestic markets, from my perspective, and the international markets. And I want to say something about them, because I think that for that, you need a clear strategy also to be competitive. And I think it's similar like a company where you have a two-folded strategy. On the one hand, you have maybe a premium brand, but then you have also a very competitive brand. And I think this should also be to defend home markets. If you now discuss about CIP, about CAP, you could say there is one strategy to secure your home market, but it's also very important to look at external markets. And I think how have we changed now to these challenges? One, as has been before, is very important. I think we have to cooperate along the whole supply chain. So I think it's very important to bring in the producers. And if you look, this was only a model, for example, in organic farming. We do have contracts with the farmer, with the warehouse, with the bakery, with the mill. So it's a much more qualified, integrated approach. And I think maybe this is also a possibility to react on this volatility in prices. Because if you have a huge, very good cooperation, it's better than you buy only on spot markets. So there are instruments that you also can then react. And one, which is very important from my perspective, is that you really need an holistic approach along the whole supply chain to work together with the partners.
And so in this developing, you're developing a market, some consumer demand for organic goods, and you are not necessarily going to be able to provide all those organic goods from within Europe. Are you happy from a point of view of food security to be encouraging, nurturing, paying for land outside Europope to be used for in a more extensive manner to produce organic stuff than maximizing production elsewhere? You're happy to do that?
No, the answer is a very simple one, because it's a very specific question, and we focus mainly on Austria, for example, in organic. It's a clear strategy that we really focus on Austrian ingredients. So we don't have, I don't know from wherever, other countries' organic products, because we think it's not sustainable. You cannot bring in under an organic umbrella, I don't know, some onions from China or whatever. So it's a clear strategy,
so
but
need,
this is a different.
I need another retailer in the room who is doing that.
There are many others. And
Could we get the microphones going?
I think it's also a question of strategy, but you're right, and I think this is a big challenge for European agriculture to really also try to meet challenges or to meet exports and to be able also to export the products. And therefore, I mean also this differentiation. I think it's not easy to have a one single model, because then you have these different incentives. On the one hand, the European consumer, and on the other hand, international markets.
I'm serious about the microphones. A quick sprint up and down the aisles with those microphones. Is there anyone wanting to come in? There, sir. We've got to do this quickly. So stick your hand up very high and keep it up if you want to speak.
Yes. I'm Eric Mathis from Leuven University. I think food industry and supermarkets do have a big play to role in avoiding waste, given their, you know, buy three, get one free kind of attitude. So are they really serious about tackling waste if it means reducing demand?
I'm just going to take the point, because we're on a timescale. Hands up if further points. This could be great. This could mean that
it's
I'm...
one over here.
Okay.
Yes, Daniel Rama from the Agribusiness Department, Catholic University in Italy. Well, I have a reaction about the idea of the double brand of the European agriculture. I think we shouldn't forget that Europe is a small appendix of the Asian continent. I mean, I don't think that Europe's mission is to feed the world, the vast majority of the world population. And I think that as far as we try to be cost competitive on the huge world market, we will always find somebody who is more competitive than us. I think that European agriculture has a mission to feed the world, but with his high standard for the high standard demand in the world.
Okay. Could we give these people carrying the microphone some exercise? Are there any questions on the up the steps? I can see nothing. Which is fine. It means that you're ready to vote, I think, unless anyone here has a burning point to make. I'm trying to bring this thing back to its timetable.
Well, just that I do think we haven't quite tackled, have we, this trade-off between the demands that we see for higher productivity that Lester laid before us, the attitudes we see in some countries really aware of that and really wanting to drive productivity, and yet here in Europe we're still somewhat on the edge of recognizing the importance of both productivity and sustainability. I think we still face this dilemma, and only to underline the fact that I think, as other speakers have said, we can have both here, but we have to enable farmers to do it with technology and support and advice.
No, I wanted to come back just 1 minute on the waste question.
Okay. Yeah.
This is something we really are working very hard on. I think there's a limit to what we can do as one player in the whole chain, because this waste starts right up at the top of the chain and goes right down to the bottom of the chain. So work has to be done right through the chain, and we are working hard on this, not on our own, but also with our partners. We're working with the packaging people, we're working with the transporters, we're working with the farming community, we're really working hard on this waste question. So let me reassure the chap from the University of Leuven, I think, that we are doing what we can here. I think for the three for the price of two, that's a question you maybe colleague in the retail sector would like to take up.
Fernand. This is a very important issue, and we're working very intensively, and I would like to give you a very interesting example. If you look to the life cycle of a product, if you don't solve this problem, you can forget everything. You can forget your resources in energy, whatever. If you throw it away, your life cycle analysis is gone. So we started very intensively to do a lot of internally, but what was very interesting, we started the communication with our consumers. In 14 supermarkets in Vienna, we started a pilot project where we made advertisement and we said, sorry, dear consumer, it's now 6 in the evening, we don't have the full range and assortment in the bakery. It doesn't work. So the consumer is not accepted yet. So we really have to bring in also the consumer and try to convince him, because consumers, they complain, they say, sorry, we are not interested.
Because basically they want the full range, up to the point the shop closes, and that means that you then waste the stock after that time.
So I think too many questions we discuss here, we have to bring in the consumer and we have to start a dialogue with the consumer.
But you could be more proactive in telling him what you think.
We did. On the sign it was standing, we want to reduce our waste. Therefore, there is not the whole arrangement, but it was interesting.
Lester, quick word from you. How far up the food chain do you think this question about of the problems that you identify, do you think they're being heard? You've got 10 seconds to answer.
I think there's still a tendency to think these are temporary. From the food industry point of view, I think one of the questions to be asking is, if grain prices do remain high and perhaps go even higher, what does that mean in terms of the position of your particular markets on the food chain? How much downward adjustment will occur and how will that affect your retailing activity? That's just one of the consequences of tightening food supplies.
Good. On your voting machines, please, the questions are going to fire up behind me now. How to best improve the functioning of the food supply chain? You want me to stall for time because you haven't found your voting things, I can tell. Strengthen farmers' bargaining position in the food supply chain. You've got 20 seconds from now. Increase transparency of prices along the food supply chain. Adjust competition policy and the one that Stephen doesn't like. So I won't even read it out. Less than 10 seconds. How to best improve the functioning of the food supply chain. And the answer is? increased transparency of prices along the food supply chain, with a big chunk for strengthened farmers' bargaining position in the food supply chain. I would like there to be the apostrophe to be after the S on farmers. There's more than one farmer, I think. Second question. What is the most important aspect for you when buying your food? This is a very personal question. 25 seconds.
The most.
There are lots of questions, but they're all pretty easy. Price, quality, brand label, packaging, how the food was produced, where the food was produced, and we don't mention the other one. So you have 10 seconds. And it's a big vote for PGIs. The answer is quality. Well, it depends what you mean by quality. With prices 17%, so that's actually we should have checked. We should break that down by how many of you are Eurocrats, shouldn't we? The famously price insensitive Eurocrats. Next question. Which is the most effective instrument to combat price volatility? Continue the single farm payment. Ensure minimum income for farmers through safety nets, le filet. Strengthen farmers' bargaining power towards other players. You've got 20 seconds left. And the answer is complicated. It's 23% regulate financial speculation, so that's the Sarkozy line of attack, is narrowly ahead of 22% strengthen farmers' bargaining power, the Porrig-Walsh argument, and where are we? 17% at the bottom with introduced strategic storages, or bring back storage for the sugar regime, I say. And I think that's the last question. We do hope so. I am going to stop there then and thank on your behalf Lester Brown, Werner Rutscher, John Atkin, and Mella Fruin. And we are all going to go off that way, and the next panel is going to come on from that side. And Alan Buckwell will get a chair this time.